He could be anywhere in the world, but he's in Pleasantville. Please welcome John Grisham.
I'm delighted to be here. I've never been here before, and happy to be here. I'm here because of you. You invited me to come, so I'm here.
Yeah, I invited you to come out of the clear blue sky, thinking, what have I got to lose? And you said yes.
Well, you know, I don't tour much. For years, I didn't tour at all, and I started a few years ago going to a few towns, and we had a great conversation a couple years ago at a bookstore in Connecticut, R.J. Julia's bookstore in Connecticut, and had a long dinner, a long night, a lot of fun together. And
you're going to start with that?
I'm not going to start.
Please don't start with that.
That's all I'm going to say about that. But I went around to like 25. Bookstores. I love to go to independent bookstores all over the country and check out the bookstores because I love to hang out at bookstores. But I would go to a store and invite a local writer, and wherever I went, in Texas and Arkansas and Mississippi, Kansas, I would invite a couple of local writers or two to come to the store, and we would tape a podcast of a conversation for an hour and a half with the writers and in a small, intimate setting just like this, where people can ask questions and take part in the program. And we had so much fun. And so we had the podcast, it's called Book Tour, and I started touring again. And also, book sales are steadily declining overall. That's a 30-year trend, regardless of all the factors that go into that. But, you know, as Americans, we buy fewer books and read fewer books every year. So. There's always the constant, not pressure from publishers, but suggestions from publishers. Hit the road, okay? Get out there and drum up support. And I talk to writers like, you know, Stephen King and Dan Brown and people I know, and we say, you know, we should.
He's a very small peer group.
Well, but it's a lot of fun. I enjoy it. I love situations like this, settings like this, where you have a crowd of people who love books and book lovers like you, who for many years, you know, was the most influential book critic in America, and for the most part said nice things about my books, with a couple of exceptions. But anyway, you don't hold a grudge. But it's enjoyable for me.
Number one, I wasn't. But number two, there was somebody else who was. And number two. The way we met wasn't actually at R.J. Julia's. We met because I wrote a story about you for the Times Book Review, and the occasion of the story was John Grisham leaves Charlottesville and goes out in the wider world, because you had not toured for, like, except to go to a few special southern bookstores. You had pretty much been in private for all the time you were writing. You were not a public person, and when we did the interview, we sat in a hotel in Soho, or below there, or someplace, and we sat for about 3 hours, and he looks does he not look exactly like his book cover photos? Nobody looked twice at him. It was just amazing. You're just not recognizable in the hip part of New York, or...
No. I walked down the streets of New York City today, doing book stuff. We started off with CBS this morning. We did interviews here and there. I walked around New York. We took the train up here a while ago, which is always a lot of fun for me because I didn't ever get to ride the train. But not a single person stopped me today. No one even looked twice at me. And I tell people, I love that, okay? I'm a famous writer in a country where nobody reads. So it's a right amount of fame. I have the name recognition. I sell the books, but I mean, I have a very normal life. Nobody ever bothers me. We don't live with security or entourages or assistants or whatever. You know, I don't live that way.
Isn't it freaky that nobody ever spots him? I don't know.
About once a year, somebody will stop and say, "Hey, you're," but they can't really call the name. Okay. "Hey, you're," and I just keep going. I say, "Yeah, no, I'm not him, okay?"
Is there anybody they mix you up with?
Yeah, and this crowd probably wouldn't know that. There's a basketball coach named Rick Barnes who coached at Clemson, Texas, and now he's at Tennessee. And during March Madness of every year, and he's a good coach. His teams are always in the tournament. And he just, and we live in that neck of the woods, you know, he coached at Clemson, and now he's at Tennessee, we're in Virginia. ACC basketball, SEC basketball, a lot of fans will mistake us together. And I'm aging better than he is, but anyway, he and I never met him, but we have some mutual contacts. The resemblance is pretty uncanny. Most of the time, you don't think you look like somebody else. People say, oh, you look like so-and-so. You never see it in your own face. But I have to admit, we kind of favor each other. And so we've sent messages back and forth. So the trick is I'm going to show up at a basketball game one night in Tennessee on the sideline. We're going to wear matching suits, matching ties, matching everything. And just I'm not sure. It'll never happen, but it's fun to talk about.
All right, so when you came out at that point, the book was Amelia Island, and it was really an experiment to see whether you liked going out in public or not. Apparently you like it, because you've been doing it ever since. This morning on Good Morning America, you've been there last year. You didn't like it when they said that you'd sold 3 million books, because that's the number.
I'm sorry, 300.
300, excuse me. Excuse me. I'm really sorry. And you said that's what you said last year, it's more.
But nobody has any idea how many books I've sold, because I have no idea. I mean, the books are now translated into 55 languages around the world. I can't even name them all. And no one has any idea how many books we sell in South Korea or Lithuania. It's just a number that I think the people at Doubleday cook up and expand every year to make it sound. It sounds pretty damn good. 300 million sounds pretty good. So it'll be 320 next year, and then 350, and it'll keep going.
Well, I'm going to give everybody an idea of how, just approximately how many books you've sold, because when we were doing our conversation for the Times article, the Amelia Island has to do with the original manuscripts of F. Scott Fitzgerald in the Princeton Library. And I asked you you collect books, and I asked you if you had a first edition of The Great Gatsby, and you didn't. And your very wonderful and hilarious publicist, Todd, I didn't notice it, but he disappeared at that point. And then when there was a special small party to honor the publication of Amelia Island, what were you presented with but a first edition of The Great Gatsby, which means your publisher really values you, which means you sell a lot of books someplace.
It was an incredible gift, and I was not expecting it, because I had never found a copy of a suitable first edition of The Great Gatsby. And Todd Dowdy, where's Todd? Todd's back there with Suzanne Hurst, my publisher. Todd's they run Doubleday, okay? They tell me what to do. And they sneaked out, and they found a copy of The Great Gatsby and gave it to me as a very wonderful gift. That's what I enjoy collecting. That's all I collect.
All right. At that point, you had about 5 ideas in the pipeline. For topics, not for books necessarily, but for things you were going to go at. And one of them, the next one up, was the Rooster Bar. And so the topic was for-profit law schools. This book is about, it's the Guardians, but it's modeled on something like the Guardians. Can you explain to everybody what the Guardians is?
Yeah, the book is inspired by a person. A guy named James McCloskey, who is in Princeton. And 45 years ago, James McCloskey was a divinity student at Princeton. He was going to become a minister. And he got involved with a prison ministry. And he met a guy in a prison in New Jersey and got to know him very well. And the guy kept saying, look, I'm innocent. They got the wrong guy. I can prove it. And these conversations, Jim was very suspicious at first. And the inmate eventually convinced Jim of his innocence. And so Jim started digging, and he had no skill. He wasn't a lawyer. He had no skills. He was not an investigator. He was a student. And he went back to the police file, the scene of the crime. He talked to some of the original witnesses, and he started noticing discrepancies, and he kept digging and digging and digging. Long story short, 2 years later, he walked that guy out of prison, exonerated. And Jim said, at that moment, it was like a calling from God. This is your life's work, to rescue the innocent from prison. And for 45 years, Jim McCloskey, he founded an outfit called Centurion Ministries, now based in Princeton, a really nice nonprofit that they litigate from coast to coast right now, all innocence cases. But in the early days, Jim had nothing. He had no money, very little money. He had no base, no support, no staff, and he would take two or three cases at a time, like a lone gunman just roaming the country, corresponding with inmates, reviewing cases, taking several cases at a time. And after 45 years, he is responsible, directly responsible, for exonerating and freeing 63 inmates, and some from death row, 62 men and one female. That's his life's work. And about 15 years ago, I went to a fundraiser that he had in Princeton, and he had 22 of his guys there from all over the country, and I hung out with them. And being around these men who are free because of Jim McCloskey was, at times there was not a dry eye anywhere. We were all emotionally, you know, when they tell their stories and what this guy's meant to them. He finally retired, but Centurion now has a staff of lawyers, investigators, and go to the website. Just Google Centurion Ministries. They have a beautiful website. And he was the inspiration for my character in the Guardians, a similar guy who was an Episcopal priest, a lawyer, then a priest, who takes a few cases. And the suspense comes because he takes a case in Florida that he shouldn't take. Because for every innocent person in prison, there's a guilty one free out there somewhere. And almost all of them are still doing bad things. I'm on the board of the Innocence Project in New York, have been for 10 years. And I think our number is now 365 DNA exonerations in the last 25 years. People we've walked out, 25% from death row. And when you get these people out, half the time with DNA testing, half the time when we exclude our guy and get him out, we're able to nail the real killer or the real rapist. And so we're putting away people. But most of the time, they're already in prison because they're career criminals. They're career rapists or serial, whatever. But we're able to, what was your question? I can go on for a long time if we start talking about wrongful convictions.
My question was, what was it about? But I think we got that.
We got that.
Okay.
Well, I answered that.
All right, so do you still start writing on January 1st every year? That's what you used to do for the fall book?
I start writing the fall book, the legal thriller, the big, thick book, every year on January the 1st. And I finish it by July the 1st, 6 months. And it takes a month or two in the summertime to clean it up, edit, and all that. And then I'm done with it. I knew in January that my pub date this year was October 15th, today. And I'll know, you know, next January what the pub date is for next year. And we kind of work backwards, and we've been doing it now for a long time. So, yeah, I'm.
So you have the date, you have the guy, you have the idea. How do you get to the story?
Well, the story is, the story takes time. There are always several stories. The good ones stick around mentally, you know, I can visually, I can see the story. They rattle around for a long time. Most of them don't work. Most of them disappear. The good ones, I'll start taking notes. You know, this is, I've got to see a very compelling hook to get you hooked early. I want you hooked early. I want you staying up late at night, just skipping work, skipping lunch, you know, calling in sick, lying to your boss. That's what I love that, okay?
I didn't lie to my boss, but I don't actually have a boss anymore, but I have a story due, and I tried to say that I had this long-standing commitment to do this, and they tried to say, you know, we're the New York Times, and we like to feel that we come first. And anyway, you just made me feel guilty.
When I finally get the opening, and hopefully an ending that you don't see coming, If I get those two, the hard part is the maintaining the narrative tension in the middle for 300 pages. That's the hard part. Once I can, you know, once I see all that, some of the outlines will take. I've been working on some outlines for many years, and if it goes on for many years, it's not going to work. But it's a process I go through. For example, I just read the headlines. There's a big, thick book somewhere with the opioid crisis. I mean, the lawsuits are raging. The politicians are involved. 150 Americans are dying every day. I mean, this is a big story. Mm-hmm. Okay, I can't get my brain around it right now. I cannot get the story down pat. I hope I do, because I want to write about it. For years, I struggled with Guantanamo. We've had people, inmates at Guantanamo for 15 years now that have never been brought to trial, and there's no real evidence that they're guilty. But they were captured, many of them captured by our forces around the world. They were tortured, many of them, okay, by our people, sent to Guantanamo, and they're still there. From a legal standpoint, it's fascinating. But I never could get the story down. So I'm always working on that story. For-profit law schools.
Well, you got them.
I read a magazine article. It was that simple. It was a great magazine article called The Great Law School Scam. And I read the article, and I said, that's a novel. That's a book, I mean, right there. And it happened like that. So some ideas happen quickly. Some take a long time to kind of gestate and come to fruition. But I'm always, you know, I have two or three ideas. I'm very much aware right now it's October 15th. January 1 is going to be here pretty soon. And it's time to, you know, get serious about
it. You haven't picked the next one yet?
Yeah, I can't talk about it. I mean, it's brilliant. Well, you're going to love it. You're going to love it.
Well, this is a really serious question. You've gotten this far without really polarizing anybody. You are a principled guy. You've stood up for all kinds of righteous causes, and yet, even in a country that is so divided right now, that in this town, fights have broken out in restaurants. Over political things, when somebody overhears somebody say the wrong something that they don't like, how do you listen to the news and pick up what's going on and figure out how to navigate those waters without, or are you willing to polarize now?
I take some stands, and then I'll catch a little bit of flack from people I don't care about. For example, the death penalty. Mm-hmm. I grew up loving the death penalty. As an evangelical Christian in the Deep South, it's just kind of ingrained in your blood. You got to love the death penalty, you know, but you got to want to kill folks who commit crimes in the name of Christ. And that's what, you know, that's the way I was raised. And it took me a long time to get that out of my system and realize how bad the death penalty is, how unfair it is, and all the things that are wrong with it. And so I've written about the death penalty, in a few books. When it comes to wrongful convictions, that's really a nonpartisan issue, because it's hard to argue with a DNA exoneration where some poor guy served 30 years for somebody else's crime. That takes all the politics out of it. Although there are some, you know, really hardcore pro-prosecution people, law and order people who don't like the fact that I criticize policemen and prosecutors who are responsible for wrongful convictions. I don't really want to get into politics. I've thought about abortion for years. There's a novel there, but I'm not sure I'm ready for that. I'm not sure I want to. I'm very, very political, quietly, as I think most people should be. We all have our political beliefs, but just because I have some type of platform doesn't mean I should spout off all the time. I don't want to hear somebody else's politics all the time. If it's somebody I enjoy their music or acting or books or whatever, you know, athletes, I don't want to hear their politics. So I don't stay. Thank you. I don't run from politics. We support a lot of people. My wife and I do. But I'm not ready to write a political thriller.
You said this morning that the death penalty is becoming almost extinct because not because it's been, you know, voted down or because of any legal reasons, but because you answered that question this morning. So Well, I'm asking you to answer it.
It's an amazing story in the past 10 years how few death verdicts are being returned in the death belt, states that are, even in Texas, where they love the death penalty. And there's almost no executions now. And I live in Virginia, which has executed more people than any state except Texas. And we have 3 people on death row in Virginia. So the death penalty is dying, not, as I said this morning, not because of courageous lawmakers and not because of courageous judges, but because of courageous jurors. And the way the cases are tried now, the defense has a lot, the defense lawyers, capital defense lawyers have a lot more resources to show the jury this defendant's entire life. Now the crime is, some of these crimes are beyond description, okay, that these people do. But if you understand where they came from, and has most of these people never had a chance in life, you can have some sympathy to the point of not voting to kill them. And so life without parole has become what jurors do. You know, this lock this person up for a long time so they can't harm anybody else, and maybe they can be rehabilitated, maybe not, but just get them off the street, but let's don't kill them. And I've made this argument many times. We can all agree that killing is wrong. We can all agree on that, okay? You know, voluntary killing. Why is the state allowed to kill? Why do we as Virginians and Mississippians assume we have the right as the governing people to sanction state killing? If it's wrong, it's wrong. And so that's why I make that argument. And again, it's as a nation, we're getting there. We're getting there as a country. Congress is never going to, you know, Trump and Sessions, they want more death penalty cases, federal death penalty cases. They've made that announcement. They want to prosecute more people. So the politicians are, you know, they have to get reelected. So they're going to always be pro-law and order. But individual jurors who hear these cases are showing a tremendous amount of courage and saying, let's show a little bit of compassion here and not kill them.
Does anybody ever pick you for jury duty?
Yeah, I got in Oxford, Mississippi, 25 years ago, I got a jury summons in a criminal case, and I showed up, and I was on the second row, and they kept,
Before you published a book.
Yeah, no, I'd published several by then, and it was a small town of Oxford where I was living then, and I knew the defense law, I knew the judge, I knew a lot of people, and they knew me, and it became apparent that I might get close to being on the jury. And so during a recess, I asked the bailiff, I said, can I talk to the judge for a minute? He said, so I went back in the back to the judge's chambers, and I said, look, judge, I knew the judge very well. I said, I'm serving. I'll be happy to serve. I believe in serving on the jury. I'm not going to run from it. If you want me to serve, I understand. I was a criminal defense lawyer. I understand the defense. I understand the prosecution. I can be fair, but I'm afraid that the other jurors may tend to listen to me more than they should. And that's all that was said. He said, thank you. I went back out, and I was not selected. And I was so happy I wasn't selected. I was so happy to walk out of that courtroom, you know, a free
man. Do you get summonses now, or is it?
That's the only one in my whole life.
Okay, all right. So he just took you off the rolls.
Well, no, I mean, we're registered voters in rural Virginia right now, and my wife got a summons a few years ago, and she showed up, you know, let's go. We believe in it, but she got excused. And well, if I got one tomorrow, I'd show up in court and do
my duty. I'm sure you wouldn't. You'd be right out of there.
I wouldn't last very long.
We're a movie theater. We're going to show a movie tonight. We're showing The Firm.
All 2 hours of it?
It's 2 hours and 45 minutes.
I know. It's way too long.
You don't like any of the movies that were made out of your books. Or maybe you like A Time to Kill, but...
No, I never said that.
You did to me.
But, Janet, that was late one night over dinner. And it was confidential, okay? I've had 10 books adapted. I've been very lucky.
You've had some very good directors.
I have had most of the movies were good directors with big cast, good screenwriters, Most of them had big, you know, they were fun to watch. Of the 10.
This one's really fun to watch.
What, the firm?
Yeah.
Yeah, but here's the thing with the firm. It came out in 1993, 26 years ago.
The movie it's Tom Cruise with his old nose.
Yeah.
It is.
But the movie, I watched the movie of the firm four times in the first 10 days. The first premiere was in New York City at some big ritzy thing, black tie. I don't know why we were there. It's the worst place in the world to watch your own movie, okay? And I'm sitting there with, it was a fun evening. But then we had a premiere in Memphis and a premiere in Oxford and a premiere somewhere. I watched the movie and I wrote the damn book. I know how it ends, okay? And so I'm,
I'm thinking,
I'm tired of this movie, okay? That was a long time. I hadn't seen it since. I don't want to watch it.
Were you involved with it at all? Were you involved with any of them?
No, we were involved. No. No. I've always said, many years ago, this is a funny story.
This can be Michael Crichton.
when the second or third book came out, I got a letter one day from Stephen King. And he said all kinds of nice stuff. But what he said was, "Welcome to the big leagues. You know, I love your books, whatever." So we got to be buddies, and he came to Oxford for a book festival 25 years ago. And we went, he wanted to go riding around in a pickup truck to view rednecks, real rednecks.
Wait a minute, there weren't any rednecks in Maine?
I said, I'll show you some rednecks. I guess they don't have in Maine, but they wanted to come in Mississippi and we'd go around looking at rednecks. And so we did that for, you know, for about 30 minutes, it got pretty boring. But he said, he got tired of seeing rednecks. And he said, look, we talked about everything. He said, here's the deal with Hollywood. And this guy's had every experience from Kathy Bates winning the Oscar for Misery to actually filing a lawsuit trying to stop a movie one time. He's had every, and he gets way too involved in them, and he still does. But he said, when it comes to Hollywood, there are two groups of writers. The first group consists of those who do not sell their stuff to Hollywood. Whatever the reason, I'm not going to deal with you, okay? That's a small group. The second group consists of those of us who do, and if you're going to sell to Hollywood, there are a couple of three rules. First of all, get all your money up front, kiss it goodbye, and expect it to be something different. If you don't like that, go join the first group. And I took his advice. So I've never fretted the movies. Of 10 adaptations, 9 were fun to watch.
Is this 10?
No. No, this is fun to watch. The Chamber was a bad movie from beginning to end. Nobody went to see it, and I was very happy nobody went to see it. But it was only dud. But the rest of them have been well done. They're on TV tonight. I've been lucky with Hollywood. I would love to have every book adapted to film. I mean, I've had 40 books, only 10 movies. I mean, it's all for sale. show me a deal, okay? And we get calls every day. Now with television, the explosive growth of streaming and television and internet stuff, it's just, there's so many TV shows being made. So we get a lot of inquiries there. It's fun, but nothing is getting done. As you know, Hollywood does not make a lot of smart adult dramas anymore.
I do know that. Yeah.
You know that. I mean,
they're
off making, you know, Spider-Man 10 or whatever. That's the Hollywood model, is that the big action flicks, and so you don't get a whole lot of smart adult dramas.
Amelia Island was such a terrific book, and it had a female protagonist, which would seemingly have opened you up to a whole other bunch of Hollywood people who might have come after it. No.
Well, I wouldn't sell Camino Island because it was one of three. I'm writing the second one now.
Oh, good.
And so,
did anybody read that? Who? Well,
we have to sell Camino Island because I didn't want to see it filmed that's a long shot. But I didn't want to see that done until I finished all three of the books. And so I'm writing the second one now, and I'll write the third one in a couple of years. And once those three are done, we may look back and sell the film rights. So I think it'd be a fun movie.
It'd be a really fun movie.
The first book was a lot of fun to write.
Yeah. Has anybody ever come to you and wanted you to write an original series, fiction series for the screen? And would you do it?
I wouldn't do it. I've written a couple of screenplays trying to, you know, get movies made, and they were pretty bad. And it's just a different set of muscles. And I've learned, I actually wrote a screenplay one time and financed the movie. It almost bankrupted me. It was a Little League baseball movie that we did almost 20 years ago, and we filmed it. And we couldn't even find a distributor. And so I learned that lesson the hard way. Don't go write books. I can do one thing, let somebody else make the movies, let somebody else write the TV shows, just write the book. Get paid for writing the book, and if somebody else wants to make the movie, let them make the movie.
You had a pretty funny situation with Michael Crichton where you were kind of competitive about the movies. You told me that once.
We had the biggest racket in the world going. I never met the guy. It goes back to 1992 when I sold the Pelican brief. Alan Pakula bought it for, I think, Paramount, and they paid a record price. Then Michael came back and sold, it may have been Jurassic Park or something, and he topped my record price. And so then I sold the client, and my agent knew what his agent got for, and we went back and forth. And there was a time when I said, all I want is one more dollar than Michael Crichton. And he was saying, I want one more buck than Grisham. And we had a beautiful racket going for many years. This is back in the early 90s, my agent would take the manuscript. When I finished a manuscript and I would send it to New York, he couldn't wait to get it. He would take it to LA, run 20 copies of it, give to the studios, and they would have an auction. Sit around a room, and Warner Brothers and Paramount, Universal, Disney Touchstone, all the big studios would start throwing money at us, and we'd take the best deal, and then they would hire a screenwriter, and then a good screenwriter, a director, a cast. And a year later or two, they're making the movie. And the movies all had big box office grosses, domestic and foreign, and they're on TV somewhere tonight. And for some reason, that model doesn't work today. We can't get it done. I have not had a movie made in 15 years. And we're trying, okay? I mean, I don't try a lot, but there are people who are trying. We have agents in Hollywood who are trying to push the books to get films made, or TV series, or whatever. It's just very difficult to do.
Have you ever thought of writing a book that stars an animated character?
I don't think...
I was kidding.
Again, I'm going to stick to lawyers. Okay. I mean, I do one thing well.
What about the fact that people don't read anymore? Do you have statistics about that? People actually buy fewer books per year?
Yeah. Well, we know that. The Americans buy fewer books every year. It's not a big trend down, but it's a soft trend. And the average American reads fewer books a year. And what's really troubling is we're worried about kids. I do a kids series, Theodore Boone, for middle grade, ages 10 through 12. And we're watching those numbers real close, and we're worried that kids are spending all their time, free time, doing other things but reading. And that's really got us worried. And so we have initiatives to encourage kids to read and all that. But yeah, the trend is we read fewer books every year. So it's just troubling. I can only worry about certain things.
Okay.
I'm worried about the next book.
All right. Do we want to do a couple of questions from the audience? They cannot be about politics, okay?
Oh, I don't care. I don't care.
Oh, they can be about anything.
Yes, sir, right here.
Wait, we have to get a microphone.
We don't need a mic.
We have to get a microphone going.
Somebody's coming. You're second, okay?
What inspired you to write Calico Joe?
Oh, the inspiration for Calico Joe. I love baseball, and I'd written two football books.
Don't you have nine baseball fields?
I have seven baseball fields in my Little League baseball park. That's about around the corner from my house. I built 25 years ago for the kids in the area because there were no ball fields around, and I'm still the Little League commissioner. I own the ballpark. I would love to give it to somebody who could maintain it, but it's going to be mine forever. And I have my only business card. It says John Grisham, Little League Commissioner. So I love baseball. I had two football stories, bleachers and playing for pizza. That I really love those. I mean, I love sports, and so I love those stories. And I kept waiting for 20 years for a baseball story, and I just couldn't get one. And I was always fascinated by the story of Tony Conigliaro and the beanball in 1969 when he got beaned and had ruined his career. And so anyway, it kind of fell into place after that. With the kid and his father and the conflict. And by the time I had it worked out, it was something I was really proud of. And I'd love to do another baseball story. I'm waiting on the story. I want to do a basketball book. But you have to wait on the story. And it may hit tomorrow. I mean, that's the great thing about the fun thing about what I do. I'm always just looking for an idea that might become a full-length novel.
Do you have one of those business cards on you?
No, I don't carry a business card. I use them for my luggage. You have to have your card for the name tag on your luggage.
Oh.
I have like 7,000 in a drawer, and I just never use them.
Oh, okay. I was going to get you to sign one. We'd frame it in our lobby.
So I love your books about, you know, law, lawyers. I'm not an attorney, but I love it. But what I really like is that all your books, you like the main character, and I like things to work out.
Can you hear in the back?
In every one of your books, the main character, the most important thing works out for the main character, right? Not everything. They'll be safe from the law. They don't get the money. They help somebody else, but they don't get the money. So do you plan, like at the beginning, saying, I'm going to make sure this works out for the main character, but he can't have everything?
It's all planned. John Irving is I love John Irving's books. And John Irving, and I did this with him a few months ago in Toronto. We had a great time. He says that he writes the last sentence before he writes the first. I'm not that smart, but I know the last scene before I write the first one. And I have these little rules of fiction, writing popular fiction, and one rule is, one of my strongest rules, do not write the first scene until you know the last one. Because when you write suspense and mystery and thrillers and, you know, thick novels that are, you know, 500 pages long, you better know where you're going when you start. It's so easy to get lost. I have writer friends who have a great idea, to consume with this idea for a novel. And they'll jump into it and write like crazy for a year. And get halfway through, or almost two-thirds of the way through a book, and stop cold because they don't know the ending. They've written themselves into a corner, and they can't get out of it. And they become, that's why writers drink so much. They really not crack up, but they just really fade and die because they cannot. And I tell them, you've just wasted a year. Tell me your last scene before you write your first one. And I'm dead serious about that. Every time, when I turned in A Time to Kill 30-something years ago, it was the first thing I'd ever written, and I didn't know what I was doing. It was 1,000 pages long. It took me 3 years. It was a mess, okay? But I got a great editor at a small press in New York, and he cut a third of that book out. That was a year of my life. And I said, I'm never doing this again. I'm never going to waste a year. I'm going to know exactly what I'm doing when I get started. And so that's how I, with The Reckoning, a book that came out last year, my challenge with the book was to take you, the reader, down to the very last page of a very thick book before the mystery was solved. And I was so happy. I could hear people cussing me because I took you all the way down to the end. And it worked. It worked fine. So that's how I write.
How did this one get, what do you call that when you're on a rope and you're over the pit of alligators? How did it get that scene in it?
Well, let's don't ruin it.
You talked about it on television this morning.
Yeah, there's a scene in the book, this book, that I stole. I read it somewhere else 30 years ago. about some of the methods used by cartels. And Don Winslow, our friend, who's a great writer, is, you know, you like his books, I like his books. He's written two or three about the cartels and their violence and ruthlessness, and it's hard to believe, and he knows what he's talking about. But some of the methods they use to punish, exterminate informants and people like that, and that's where I got the idea of the crocodile pit.
Crocodiles.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's all we can say.
Okay.
When you first started, if you go way back, and you submitted your first work, how long did it take for the whole process before you were published, and how did you handle that initial submission?
It was before the internet, obviously. It was 1987. I wrote A Time to Kill over a three-year period from 84, 85, 86, early to 1987. And I'd read, you know, how to do this, how to do that, so I knew sort of what I was doing. And I made a submission, which was a cover letter and three chapters, and I sent 10 of those off to 10 publishers in Manhattan, companies you know, companies out of publishing companies. And I also sent 10 to agents. Back then you could submit to agents, I'm sorry, back then you could submit to publishers and also agents. Now you can't submit to publishers. Not, you have to have an agent nowadays, but it's far different back then. So I had a list of 30 publishers and 30 editors and 30 agents. And as they would send it back, which they did immediately, the rejection letters, and I saved all of them, by the way. But they would, you know, I'd get a rejection letter back, and my secretary would just go to the next name and redo it, retype the letter. So at any given time, I had like 10, 15 submissions floating around New York City. And A Time to Kill was turned down by the first, you know, 15 or 18 publishers and about that many agents. And so there was a lot of rejection. It's kind of fun. I mean, I had a real life. I was a lawyer. I was a busy lawyer. My wife's having babies. Life is fun. Life is good. It was a part-time hobby. I was serious about it, but I had no idea it was going to work. I'd written one book. I was going to write one more book. After A Time to Kill, if the second book didn't work, I was done with it. You know, I was just going to go back and just sue people. That's my job, okay? so I got those rejections for A Time to Kill, and I didn't really, you know, it never really depressed me. It was kind of a, you know, fun thing I was doing. And I was also writing the second book. And then one day I got the magic phone call from New York, an agent, he was like number 19 on the list, and he said, I like this book, it has potential, I want to represent you. That was a big deal. And it took him a year he got rejected by everybody who'd already rejected me the first time. And then the second, you know, great phone call a year later, April of 1988, he called and said, we've sold your book. We've sold the time. It was not A Time to Kill then, I didn't have a title. A Time to Kill came out 30 years ago, June of 1989, and they printed 5,000 hardback copies, small unknown press in New York, and it was a total flop. I mean, it didn't sell. They never went back and printed more. There was no talk of paperback rights or foreign rights. It was just, you know, I was unknown, the publisher was unknown, and it was a disappointment because it didn't sell. But by then, I was almost finished with the second book, which was The Firm. And when The Firm came out in March of 91, everything changed. I mean, it changed immediately. It became a bestseller and stayed on the list for a year. And, you know, that's suddenly I was bored with the law, the law office, and politics and everything else. So I became a full-time writer.
Sidney Pollack, who directed The Firm, was a huge reader. How did he get a hold of this book?
Well, Scott Rudin bought it.
Oh, okay.
And Scott Rudin is the biggest reader in the world. Yeah. I mean, this guy reads everything. Yeah. I have a great admiration for Scott Rudin. And he reads stuff, he buys stuff, and he gets stuff made. Yeah. Whether it's movies, plays, or whatever. Scott Rudin is he's a force. But he bought The Firm, and I forget how he got Sidney Pollack involved, but Scott, you know, Scott's a big presence, and they needed a big director to kind of, keep everybody in line. And Sidney Pollack was perfect for it. Yeah. And he was a prince of a guy to me.
He was a prince.
Really great guy.
So tell everybody what you did with the 5,000 small press. Would be incredibly valuable now, editions of that, of The Time to Kill.
Well, they printed 5,000 hardback copies. I bought 1,000. And I had no idea what I was doing, but I thought, okay, I'm going to sell these. I'll make some money retail, you know, and maybe some royalties on the back end and blah, blah, blah. And so I had in my hometown, we didn't have a decent bookstore. We had a nice library. And so we had a big library party at, you know, from my hometown and where I'd lived and I'd been elected from that town. And I had 1,000 books. We have 1,000 books is a lot of books. And we have photographs of my kids who were tiny crawling on the stack copies of A Time to Kill as we're getting ready for the big book party at the library. And we had a huge party. And when the party was over, I still owned 882 copies of A Time to Kill. And I had an invoice coming to pay for that, so I panicked, and I went to my librarian the next day, and I said, okay, look, hey, I can take this show on the road. Do you have any buddies around the state? And so I hit the road with A Time to Kill in a trunk of my car, and I'd go to any little small town, and the friends, the ladies at the library would make punch and cookies, and I'd come in. We'd sell 5 copies here, 10, you know, whatever. And like 35 libraries later, I sold almost all of A Time to Kill, and excuse me, I kept about 100, I think. I just got tired of that. I mean, I had to practice law too, and those editions are pretty rare now.
Yeah, I bet. If you kept more of them, you'd be in good shape by now.
Well, I mean, this a pristine copy now goes for about $4,000, and I had 1,000 of those in my office. So do the math, okay? It's a It wasn't the only fortune I lost practicing law, but I had a lot of them. I'll buy one probably maybe once a year. Somebody will send me a letter, and they'll say, hey, I need to sell this book. My kid's going to college or whatever. And I'll say, okay, send me the book. If it's in great shape, we'll agree on the price. And I always buy them. So I've got a stash.
If we can ever get one for you, would you come back someday?
Yeah. The last one I gave away was to Barbara Bush. I gave her one, and she's a buddy. She's a great friend of mine, and I did her literacy events in Houston for years, and she was a wonderful lady. But I'll give one the guy who did A Time to Kill on Broadway. He did the play, and we got it on Broadway, and it opened in October and closed in November. But it was a lot of fun. I was not involved in it. I gave him one. So I dole them out occasionally, but they're buried in the backyard.
We have a long movie to show. I cannot thank you enough for coming way the heck out of your way to Pleasantville, New York, to this place. It's just wonderful that you did it, and you know how much I'm grateful.
I'm happy to be here. My agent, David Gernert, who I've been with for 31 years now. He was my first editor at Doubleday. Now he's my agent. He lives here in the county, and I've been to his house several times.
He lives in Pleasantville?
No. What's David's hometown? Pound Ridge.
Oh.
Is it Pound Ridge? Yeah. That's his address. So I've been to his house several times, and I'm familiar with the area. So it's a lovely part of this.
Please come back.
I'll be happy to.
Okay.
If you invite me, I'll be back.